Good afternoon, everyone. This is Brother Lloyd, also known as 287. And to those who are keeping the Sabbath today, as always, I'll be having a blessed and peaceful Sabbath. Now, today I'm going to address a comment that was made on one of my wife's videos. And this seems to be a issue from time to time, or question from some people about this thing of the wedding ring. Where is your wedding ring? Or should we wear wedding rings? Or why? And all that. So I'm going to address that, and I'm going to basically address it through some historical understanding so that everyone can have a little more knowledge about why some people do and don't wear wedding rings. So, as always, individually, you have to make your own choices and decisions based on what you believe. And on top of that, remember, this is always about believers. If you're an unbeliever, you're free to do whatever you want, because it has no relevance on what you're thinking and believing if you're attacking people who believe in something and you don't. So it's really of not that much importance. So with that being said, let's get started. Now, we have to understand that in the Bible, the value of symbols is determined by their origin and meaning. The Sabbath, the Passover lamb, the blood, the Lord's Supper, baptism, foot washing, and all these different things are valuable symbols because they have been established by what? By the Father to help us conceptualize and internalize spiritual realities. And their value is derived from their divine origin, meaning, and their function. So by contrast, we have to understand that things like the wedding ring as a symbol of marital commitment finds its origin not in Scripture, but it comes from what? Pagan mythology and superstitions and traditions and all these types of things. So to invest a pagan symbol as with a biblical meaning is, you know, it can easily lead to the secularization of the symbol itself. And that's what has happened with the ring, the wedding ring thing. So we have to understand that when we're trying to say why people should and shouldn't be doing something like wearing a wedding ring, we have to understand where this stuff comes from. Now, this is the same thing that has been done with the transformation of Sunday from a pagan holiday to a Christian holy day. And really, the success of that can be debated, because when you look at it, it hasn't been truly transformed, Sunday that is, it hasn't been truly transformed into a holy day, because there are plenty of people who keep Sunday, but not in its entirety. They keep it in a portion to worship and do what they believe to be accurate and true, but if you're going to do it, you need to do it in its entirety. If the whole day is holy, it should be treated as such. But many people, especially those who don't even worship on Sunday, they're using it as their own personal holiday for what? Their own personal pleasures and enjoyment, profit-making businesses, or what have you. So the success of transforming Sunday from a regular day to a holy day has not truly happened. So we have to understand this when we're trying to be critical of people who do keep certain days in their entirety, like Sabbath keepers. Now, to a large extent, the same thing can be said about the wedding ring. In spite of many attempts by the church leaders early on to restrict the use of a ring to just a marital ring, the historical reality is that believers, Christians, whoever, they have given in to that temptation of wearing rings for all sorts of things, and primarily for all types of adornment, because that's what people do. They wear many rings for all sorts of status quos and adornments. And also in most Western cultures, which we're one of those, in most Western cultures, it's worn on the fourth finger of the left hand, otherwise known as what? The ring finger. That's what we call it. Now, by all accounts, historically, finger rings seem to have appeared and originated with whom? The Egyptians. And that evolving comes from what? Signet rings. The Egyptians wore these rings with seals on them as a sign of power. And they used to mark everything with their signet ring. They were called seals or signet rings. And the wearer of these types of rings, they were considered people in great authority. And they were at that time. So also with that, wealthy Egyptian women wore gold rings on different fingers. So now we're getting into some of this adorning that the Egyptians were huge on. They were full of idolatry, and wearing of gold and jewelry and all these things, makeup, comes from them. They were the inventors of this, so to speak. Now, at the same time, the poor classes wore rings of less costly materials, such as silver, bronze. The more valuable the material, the higher status quo that it showed you were from. And also understand that the poor people did this, and that just showed that they were even caught up into all this idolatry of their higher class people, the Egyptians. So we have to understand that Moses dealt with a lot as he removed the children from Israel under the leadership of the Heavenly Father, because they brought a lot of these traditions and habits with them, because they spent all that time in captivity, and so they adopted all those behaviors and traditions and all these things of their leaders. This was the only thing that a lot of them knew. This is part of the reason why that after the children of Israel left Egypt, that they wandered the desert for 40 years, because they were filled with all that idolatry. Remember, they built a golden calf, because that was the stuff that was in them, worshiping idols, all this idolatrous behavior. So they suffered a lot over the course of these 40 years as the Father tried to wean them out of these behaviors and habits. And we also see that in one part, while they were wandering for these 40 years, when they were preparing for the Father to come down and actually speak to them, they had to prepare themselves. And part of that preparation was this. If you go with me to Genesis 35:2, it reads here, it says, "Then Jacob said unto his household and to all that were with him, put away the strange gods that are among you, and be clean, and change your garments." Now, strange gods are idols, statues, jewelry, all this. And then in verse 4 it says, "And they gave unto Jacob all the strange gods which were in their hand," rings, jewelry, adorning the hands, all that, "which were in their hand, and all their earrings which were in their ears, and Jacob hid them under the oak which was by Shechem." See, so they understood, they knew what the commandments were, that they shouldn't be doing these things. So when they went to see their father, they removed all this mess from off them. Now, people say, well, the commandments weren't established until we, no, they already knew the laws. The laws were established at creation, but during captivity, that was lost. They were in captivity for, 400 years. All that was lost, so the Father had to reintroduce them to it. So it was nothing that the Father is recreating. He was reemphasizing and reestablishing something that he created at foundation. Now, for those of you that study, you know that when Joseph became the second most powerful man in Egypt, Pharaoh gave him his ring in doing so and gave him that power. Joseph answered to no one other than the Pharaoh during that time. Rings are something that was clearly established by the Egyptians, and Scripture speaks about these types of rings here and there throughout Scripture. So let's find out a couple things about rings. Rings, or the circle, was what, or is what? It represents eternity. Most people know it represents eternity with no beginning and no end, not only to the Egyptians, but to many ancient cultures, it represented the same thing, and that has not changed today. Okay, now, the hole in the center of the ring was considered a gateway or door leading to things and events that are both known and unknown. So they kind of viewed the hole as kind of like a black hole, or looking to the future of the unknown. And the Romans also eventually adopted this tradition as a symbol of ownership. And it's really no different now. It shows ownership. The Romans were also the first to use ring to tie people not only to their social classes, but to their marital partners. Now, Roman men would claim their woman with the giving of what? A ring. And that's how it works today. Men claim their women by giving them these rings. And women want to be claimed. And that's why there's so much drama about receiving a ring, because they want to be claimed by a man. Now, in about 860, Christians started using these rings in marriage ceremonies. And in spite of the fact that rings were surrounded by all this pagan superstitions and traditions and customs, that didn't deter Christians from using them in marriage ceremonies. And in order to win favor from the deities that they represented, Christians made their rings according to the deity that they were trying to satisfy. But the most important one to speak on shortly is the diamond. See, everyone loves the diamond ring, and originally it's set in gold. But the diamond, or the sapphire, set in this gold represented the sun deity. So, a little history there for those of you who are intrigued with all your diamonds and your diamond rings. That represents the sun deity. Now, at the same time, the church discouraged the use of such rings as heathenish. But around the 13th century, wedding rings and betrothal rings, or engagement rings, were considered simplified, and they were given a more spiritual look. And at the same time, they end up being dubbed as a symbol of the union of hearts. So this led to the Christians not opposing it, because they viewed it or perceived it as not being an ornament, but now they looked at it as a symbol of marital commitment, and it had a more spiritual meaning to them. Now, they didn't anticipate that this engagement ring or marital ring would eventually tempt Christians to follow the same example of the pagans and start wearing all sorts of ornamental rings. And that's what has happened. People don't just simply wear a wedding band or wedding ring or engagement ring. They have all sorts of rings all over themselves. And all this does is show that accepting something seemingly so innocent always leads to the true objective of the enemy. And that is to what? Pervert it. He perverts everything from what it starts to where it ends up. So this is also an example why scripture says nothing about wearing rings to represent marriage. Our marriage is through the Father. He sanctifies a marriage. Now, wedding rings throughout different stages of history have been worn on different fingers, including the thumb and both the left hand and right hand. But according to tradition, believed to have been derived from the Romans, the wedding ring is now worn on what? The left ring finger, as we call it, because it was thought to, there was thought to be a vein in that finger that leads to the heart. But that's been scientifically or medically proven not to be true. But that was referred to as the vein of love, and that is why the Romans apparently wore it on that finger. Now, in early Christian marriages, during that ritual, the wearing of the wedding ring was done on the third finger. And as the priest would recite during the binding, he would say, "In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit," they would move the ring to different fingers to seal the marriage, so to speak. Now, there's also another theory as to why the ring is worn on the ring finger of the left hand, and one is because that finger is one of the least used fingers, especially on the left hand, with most of the world being right-handed, and it's larger than the pinky. And part of the thinking on that is because if you make rings for the pinky, it becomes an awfully small ring. So if you put it on the next largest finger and least used finger, it can be a larger ring and gives more area to decorate and adorn, as we see rings are done. So that's just one debate on that. Now, part of the bottom line is those who are in favor of wearing wedding rings feel strongly about wearing a ring as a valuable symbol to affirm their marital status and commitment, as well as letting others know their status. But on the other hand, those who choose or oppose wearing the wedding ring feel strongly based on their fact that the ring, or the golden ring, is an ornament forbidden by scripture. So even with the historical knowledge and understanding of where rings come from, the debate on wearing a wedding ring still is really based on a strong personal feeling rather than the clear understanding of all the issues involved. But scripture tells us in 1 Timothy 2:10, 1 Timothy 2:10 reads, it tells us, it says, "In like manner also, that women adorn themselves in modest apparel, with shamefacedness and sobriety, not with broidered hair or gold or pearls or costly array." Verse 10 says, "But which becometh woman professing godliness with good works." And 1 Peter 3:3 reads, it says, "Whose adorning, let it not be outward adorning of plaiting the hair and of wearing of gold or putting on of apparel, but let it be the hidden man of the heart in that which is not corruptible, even the ornament of a meek and quiet spirit, which is in the sight of the Father of great price." So other than scripture like that, the Bible gives no indication that finger rings were used as betrothal or nuptial rings or otherwise, because it doesn't speak on that. Like I said, it speaks about the signet rings, those individuals in power back then, the Romans and the pharaohs and all those people in power, they wore those types of rings. They still do it today. The people in power, the popes and all these individuals. Remember, when you look at the Pope, they are Roman. They're Roman power, they're Roman position, and they still subscribe to all this idolatry with all the rings and everything else. So they're still part of the same type of idolatry that existed then, and it has just come forward. So let's look at the adoption of the wedding ring. Well, in about 1872, the Methodist Church accepted this, and they incorporated it in what was termed as the discipline. And this is how it reads. It says, if the parties desire it, the men shall here hand a ring to the minister, who shall return it to him and direct him to place it on the third finger of the woman's left hand. And the man shall say to the woman, repeating after the minister, with this ring I thee wed, and with my worldly goods I thee endow, in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. Now that's where that first started. And a year later, in 1873, the Presbyterian Church followed. And as we see, the rest is history. It has progressed from there, and now everyone observes this tradition. In the light of these types of observation, it's evident that church standards affecting such sensitive areas as dress and jewelry can contribute to the growth of what? The decline in the church, when you start having issues that come with that. But there are also believers who observe high standards and are constantly reminded of their calling and mission to the rest of the world. So understand this, people. It's up to you as an individual to wear or adorn or do something that clearly has been created or established from a pagan history or custom. It's up to you as an individual. But keep this in mind also. If we don't, that doesn't make us untrue to our marriage vow, because we don't. But neither does it make it true that you're committed to your marriage vow, because you do. So in regards to conformity of customs and fashions, is it really necessary to cater to the world just to please people and their traditions? That's what it's always about, pleasing other people and traditions. And this is what people get caught up in. Many people wearing wedding rings and living a lie. But there are many individuals not, and living to the truth and commitment that the Father has ordained according to what marriage is all about. So be careful in adopting customs and traditions and becoming judgmental about people who don't do what you do, when what you do clearly isn't of scripture. And the said can be saying for those who are believers and keep scripture. Remember about judgment. We aren't to be judgmental. Let the Father do his work and you do yours. And with that, remember, the Heavenly Father doesn't call on us to be successful. He calls on us to be faithful. This is Brother Lloyd, 287. I'm out.